All right, welcome everybody. We're getting started right now. Welcome to the Hilltop Restaurant. This is the College of Complexes. The Hilltop Restaurant is located at Foster and California in Chicago. We start at 6 p.m. and we end at 9 p.m., okay? We have two basic things, a basic format and some basic rules. The basic rules are there's only one full at a time, and the other rule is no personal insults, no personal... And then the basic format is we give announcements, general announcements. After the general announcements, we're going to have our speaker come up and give a speech, or presentation.
Jim.
And then we're going to have question period. And please, when you're asking your question, please put it in the form of a question and not a statement. The question period is for questions only, okay? And then after the question period, the speaker is going to sit down. And then anybody can come on up and give a rebuttal to whatever the presentation was. You can share your for it, against it, you can go in left field, right field, talk about whatever you want for those 5 minutes. I'm sorry, and then the speaker always gets the last word after the rebuttal session. Thank you, sir. All right, so then we're gonna have a speaker, Sid Cohen, Dialectical Materialism.
Okay, according to Heraclitus, conception of the universe is an internal process of growing up and dying away. Everything flows, everything changes. The world is made up of opposites, among which a struggle is constantly taking place. Opposites pass into one another. Cold becomes warm. The moist becomes dry, the day becomes night, and the night becomes day. War becomes peace. All takes place within a strict and definitive process. Everything proceeds according to necessity. This was Heraclitus, who was an ancient Greek philosopher who lived around 544 to 484 BC. Dialectical materialism, the social, physical, and biological, and the laws, structures of matter. In antiquity, certain philosophers understood dialectics to mean the art of gaining truth by means of revealing contradictions in an opponent's argument, and then overcoming the contradiction. And what are the laws of dialectics? Unity and the conflict of opposites. Transition from quality to quality. Negation of the negation. In labor, the conflict of labor and capital. Time never stands still. It always is always in flux. The interdependence of all matter. In science, we never get the whole truth, but only an approximation of truth. In other words, if we didn't have that, we would have a frozen universe that is ossified. I would like to show that chaos theory is part of a process.
May I?
And that chaos leads to order.
Right with you, Pat?
Every time we resolve a contradiction, that develops into a qualitative change, change which is time, an advance in development, into a qualitative change, which is time, an advance in development and progress, an advance in development and progress. There are three forms of matter: social, the strike, biological, evolution. We get the cell, we got multiple cells, and then we get sea life. Then we get amphibians, quadrupeds, animal life, and eventually Homo sapiens. Physical. The advance in progress. Foot travel, horse, water, rail car, flight, rocket. An advance in technology. On the micro level, we have computers that keeps getting smaller and smarter. Into nanotechnology and quantum into infinity. On the quantum side and on the macro level of technology, the human eye, telescopes that get larger and larger, telescopes that will get seven times as large as the Hubble telescope, and a new telescope. With each advance in technology, we learn more and more about the laws of nature. With each advance, we get a change in physical time. A qualitative change is what time is. We also get a qualitative advance in knowledge. And there's no end to the knowledge. In this progress into infinity is in the very nature of matter itself. A materialist interpretation of two quantum photons set 7 miles apart were able to communicate with one another. And every time they tried the same experiment, they got the same result no matter how far away the two quantum photons were apart. So this experiment can be based on the dialectics, the unity of opposites, which shows order in qualitative and quantitative and in nature itself. And in primitive society, we had primitive society originally, then we had slave society, and then feudalism, and now we have capitalism and the tendency towards socialism. In the famous debate in 1930, Albert Einstein argued that Niels Bohr's interpretation of quantum, that two particles would display such coordination. And like I said before, in the experiments that showed no matter how far away it was, the two photons would communicate with one another. And that was called a projected experiment. It was called a thought experiment. It was finally done in 1978. Since that time, the experiment has been repeated in increasing distances. And that's an materialist interpretation of the coordinated process. 7 miles can be based on the dialectics of the unity of opposites. One coordinated process that shows order in nature and quantum and physics. Political, we have primitive society, feudalism, capitalism, and the built-in tendency towards socialism. What is capitalism? In a word, it is the exploitation of labor. The worker produces a product. He also produces surplus value that he never gets paid for. The true value of his labor. He works an 8-hour day but receives approximately 2 hours pay for that 8-hour day. And that's what Marx called surplus value. Because the capitalist gets that surplus value, which is profit. Of course, the capitalist has a lot of overhead that has to be paid for, like damage done to the means of production, shipping to the middleman, to people who sell the product. Even with all that, the capitalist still makes a profit. The more people he has working for him, the more profit he makes. Even with all that, the capitalist still makes, like I said, a very handsome profit. So capital is nothing but the accumulation of labor. Without the worker, there is no capital. As capital accumulates, he buys out other capitalists until you have monopolies, which gets larger and larger. And now 1% of the capitalists control 99% of the wealth. They socialize production by doing away with small businesses, control the mass media with a small amount of corporations, maybe 5 corporations, control the banks, the arm production. 41% of arms production is made by the United States. So the United States use that vast amount of wealth to buy off politicians. I'd like to talk about time. Time could move forward, never backward. A is contained in D, B is contained in C, C and D. There is something in common in all events, that the series just named, called the A, is common to all events, and series and series. Experience never finds an end to the events in either direction. This gives the series of integers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, etc., the series in dialectics, each number synthesized every previous number, and yet contain a new quality. How otherwise could we differentiate? This describes the qualities, for it describes the essential process of becoming. But time and space are not separate. There is a likeness, there is that change, and an unlikeness, the changefulness of this thing, space. So time and space are interconnected. So in society, capitalism is connected with socialism. And this happens in time and space. Let us look at cold climes. At first, humans used skins for clothing, then found out how to make fire, first from wood, then from coal, then from steam heat, and now from oil and fossil fuels. But what happens is there's a contradiction with all these various forms of energy. If you burn coal too long, coal causes smoke, things of that nature. If you burn coal, there's coal dust. Another contradiction. We overcome it by burning oil, but that particular process causes pollution. So we have to go to solar. In each of these qualitative change, we get an approximation of truth. But approximation is never the whole truth. So we have to get to the next level. When we make a qualitative change, there's never the whole truth. If there were, we would have a frozen universe, an ossified universe. In all this, we have to overcome the contradiction. That is what time is, qualitative change leading to qualitative change into infinity, because the universe is infinite. We can take one and we count to infinity. There is no end. There is no end to it. Where does this one come from? Well, we just pick it out of the environment. There is no one. There's no beginning and there's no end. So time is difference in other space and the Earth. The Earth is about 4.5 billion years old. It might take trillions of years for the Earth to disintegrate, then turn into space. But the first law of physics, matter cannot be
Created or destroyed?
Destroyed. It just turns into other forms of matter. But how about entropy? The dissipation of matter. Many scientists believe that entropy formed the basis of biological life. Entropy just forms different entities, right? Revolution, different social systems. It is a form of qualitative change. So we have a contradiction, a unity of opposites. The contradiction form of matter lasts forever. And the unity of opposites between Earth and space, a form that is inherent in all matter, a law of matter, change, a basic law that all matter is connected to each other, like the sun to the earth or the moon to the earth, which gives us gravity. Modern humans has been on this planet about 150,000 years, Homo sapiens. During the first period, we called primitive communism, because all land was held in common, no private ownership. They were hunters and gatherers. At first, they lived in clans based on common ancestry. But we don't know how long this epoch lasted. It might have lasted for thousands and thousands of years. The ancient Indians, the ancient Greeks, the Romans, the Chinese, the Japanese, the English, the German tribes, and all primitive peoples, also in Africa, how they advanced into slavery. If you could call it that, most probably through agriculture. They learned to grow crops, and they had a permanent supply of food through hunting, and this developed, and eventually they developed tools and weapons for hunting, copper and iron. Because of this advance in tool making, some clans became wealthier than others and fell into private hands. When wealth fell into private hands, the owner of this wanted to pass along to his offspring this wealth. But in primitive society, there were group marriages. He didn't know who his offspring was. So group marriages developed into monogamy, so he can pass on his wealth to his offspring. As a result, a new class arises, a slave-owning class, who till the soil, dig in the mines for copper, iron ore, but he has to protect that wealth. So a state has to be born, with the power of arms at its ready, to put down revolts, like the slave revolt in ancient Rome by Spartacus that lasted some 4 years. The largest slave revolt in Roman history. And so they had to have a state in order to repress these people who they used a slave to make all their wealth. So they had to have jails, judges, and other organs of repression. The police, the army, the navy. So now the state is coming to being, to rule by force, to keep the slaves in line, either slave or die. Wealth flows into the coffers of the slave master. But this can't last forever. Rome and slavery overextend themselves, like all empires die. Then feudalism comes into being. The German tribes came in and took over the Roman society. And they took over the land of Funtas, which were the big landed estates. Feudalism takes over when the peasants work for the feudal lord, but does not own the land. He is exploited for his labor and does not have the rights. This epoch lasted for about 500 years or so, or maybe longer than that, we don't really know. But at first, under feudalism, we had the guilds, and they made the furniture and other goods. Then in 1492, as everybody knows, Columbus discovers the New World.
anything wrong here, huh?
Discovery of the New World by the Spanish, the English stimulated profound change. New ships had to be built, masts out of cloth, lumber, iron, compasses for navigation, clothes for sailors, shoes, and all matter of trade was born. The planet had never seen all this trade. The guilds could not handle this. This immense trade and the mercantile capitalism was born. The capitalists needed workers, so they came from the lord of the states into the factories to sew the masts, build the lumber, build the ships, build the factories, the shoe factories, and so forth and so on, and into industrial capitalism, what we have today. Never before in human history were humans able to develop on this grand scale. The capitalists grew wealthy beyond their dreams, and the workers labored in miserable conditions, working from dusk to dawn, no breaks. They were wage slaves, barely able to feed their families, with little or no schooling. Their offsprings fared no better, so they tried to form unions. The capitalists called them combinations and forbid them. And what happened in New York, the shirtwaist factory in New York, where a lot of women fell to their death from these factories, the doors were locked, the place caught on fire, and a lot of them were burned to death, a lot of young women. And then, of course, we had what happened in Chicago, the struggle for the eight-hour day, where these anarchists and socialists try to have a better working day. And, of course, we know what happened to them. A lot of them were put in prison, some of them were hanged, and so forth and so on. So this is the nature of capitalism. Profit before people. Now progress has turned into its opposite. Global warming, floods, perpetual wars, low wages, and slave labor. 8 hours an hour when people need $15 to $20 an hour to have a decent life with some security, not insecurity. Never knowing when they will get fired. Capital is richer than ever. 850 people own half the wealth of the planet. Every epoch brought us progress, and now we need a new epoch to further our progress, which is socialism. This socialization lays the groundwork for socialism, which is a high level of socialization, a high level of production, so it produces a living wage not just for capital, but for everybody. So the disorder of capitalism turns into socialism, and the unity of opposites, a contradiction into its opposite, socialism. Every class society thought their society was the end of history. Like in slavery, they said it was a natural order of things for some people to be owners of slaves and some people slaves. And during feudalism, the monarchy said the same thing. It's in the nature of the feudal system, and it's in the nature of human beings in general, or human nature, that we have this type of system. And the same thing is happening in capitalism. They're telling us, this is the end of history, and we could go no further. But if we look at history of what I've said, we find that everything is in constant process of change. There's no such thing as something that stands still. If something stands still, everything would die. It's in the natural order of things for change to happen. That's it.
That's the description of dialectical materialism.
Parker.
Sid, I have heard that some places like USSR and Cuba and North Korea are really state capitalism. What thought do you have about that? Is there any pure socialism or capitalism?
I just read a book about Lenin. And he thought what would happen was, when we got socialism, what would happen is the workers would be in the process of running that society. And he also thought that Russia would start off the revolution, but would go into Germany, who had a highly developed industrial complex type of system. So socialism has to be based on a high level of production, which Russia never had. So in Russia itself, what happened was, instead of the workers controlling the country, the Communist Party controlled the country. So it was socialism, but under state control. It wasn't by the workers themselves, because the basis for socialism is a high level of production, which they never had. So he wanted to educate the workers after a certain period. But he knew they had to go into capitalism first. So he had what they called the new economic policy. That is, they would use capitalism in order to develop the country so they could go into socialism. And if you look at China, Cuba, and the rest of them, that's what essentially they're doing. So it was never controlled by the workers. It was controlled by the Communist Party and the state. So it was a socialism that wasn't completely developed.
Thank you.
Yes, Mike Weinert.
When you use the term dialectical materialism, are you using that as synonymous with dialectics in general or dialectical logic? In Hegel, he taught and really conceptualized the idea of dialectical logic in his logic and in his the courses that he taught at university. Marx wasn't one of his direct students, but others were, such as Roebling, who invented the Brooklyn Bridge and applied that logic to the problems of spanning long distances. He invented the suspension bridge in general, of which the Brooklyn Bridge is an example. So when you say dialectical materialism, are you using that term as synonymous with dialectical logic, or in the sense that of how Marx applied that to the social science?
That's part of the process. In other words, what Marx was doing
was
looking into matter itself and the laws of matter, and how to use those laws of matter in order to progress, and looking at contradictions and things, and how to overcome that contradiction so they could advance to a higher stage. Now, in this process, it's not mechanical. You have to use your consciousness in order to understand it. It's not something mechanistic, where it just takes place by itself. People that use that logic have to use it and experiment with it to see what works and what doesn't work. Like in Russia, it didn't work. It worked to a certain extent, but didn't work. So you look for the contradiction in it and try to find out where it is so you can advance to a higher degree.
Yes, Pat Butler.
Yeah, can you point today to a country which has the high degree of productivity, the high degree of worker participation, and a high degree of socialism? Would Scandinavian countries be an example of that?
No, Scandinavia is basically a capitalist country. It has what you call social democracy. Social democracy is what we had under Roosevelt. What he done is brought in a few reforms so the system wouldn't be overturned. Scandinavian countries are not socialist countries. They're basically capitalist countries. There's no country in the world that has that high degree of economic and structural advanced in technology that has socialism. China is working in that direction. Cuba is working in that direction. But it's not there yet.
Steve, I guess. Okay, so I heard you say, first of all, Karl Marx wrote a book called Das Kapital, right?
Yeah.
And he was anti-capitalism.
Yeah.
But the presentation today was capitalism is required to get to socialism. So
yeah.
Capitalism, therefore,
yeah, definitely.
Good capitalism is a foundation
yeah.
of socialism.
Right, right.
So can you agree that capitalism is good?
What happens is, with any social system, you get to a level where there's so many contradictions in it that you can't use it no longer. Like now, we have global warming, we have perpetual wars, we have perpetual unemployment. The system is breaking down, just like feudalism broke down, just like slavery broke down. All social systems break down, and eventually they have to be replaced. There's no such thing as a permanent system. You cannot have a permanent system because the nature of matter itself is constant change. And society is a form of matter. It's social matter.
Sid, I asked before, do you agree there is no good capitalism and there is no bad socialism?
Well, every system makes so many mistakes. And this is normal. Just like you're living your own life. How many mistakes did you make before you overcame them? Every system is going to make mistakes. And that is in the nature of matter itself. And you have to overcome those mistakes in order to advance to a higher stage. So there's no such thing as a perfect capitalism versus socialism. It has to develop over a period of time through these contradictions by overcoming the contradiction and advancing in time and progress and so forth. So that's part of the nature of matter itself.
Charlie Madoff.
Yeah, Sid, if centuries ago all the countries to the earth had been socialist, it sounds like nobody would have discovered America, and so it would be undiscovered, right?
Right.
We'd still be.
Yeah, but things don't. Everything is an evolution. You see, what happens is just like human beings developed out of the animal kingdom, socialism developed out of our social system.
With no capital.
Everything is an evolution. The cosmos itself, the universe, is part of an evolution.
Without capitalists to finance the void.
Huh?
Without capitalists to finance the voyages of Columbus, America would not have been discovered.
Yeah, you're right, I agree with you.
Well, that doesn't...
It was an advance over feudalism, definitely. It was a definite advance.
Yeah, I'm a kind of a cut-to-the-chase type of person. What then, if this is a constantly evolving type of thing, what then do you see as the next system coming after socialism, if that ever becomes a reality on this planet?
Well, nobody could look forward in time. It's an impossibility. The only thing that I could see is the Earth eventually will disintegrate and you won't have no social systems. That's what's going to happen anyways. It'll take billions of years, but it'll happen. Yeah, go ahead.
Why do you support socialism? I just can't see it working. You got a nice theoretical model here, but it's not reality. It's just not reality. Markets are reality. You buy something and a company exists because people want their product.
Didn't the feudal lords say the same thing?
We overthrew the feudal lords through centralized government.
Yeah, but they said the same thing. This is the nature of reality, and this is the way it is. Some people are born in the aristocracy, and some people are born to be serfs. They said the same thing.
You're a serf.
There's no such thing as a system that's going to last forever. There's no such thing.
Who wants us to be serfs?
Hey, Sid, I don't want to get into the nuts and bolts of it, but let's give an example. Brahm does 3 times the output that I do.
Yeah.
And I don't want to do a doggone thing.
Yeah.
We're socialists.
Yeah.
I like this idea because I don't want to do anything.
Yeah, okay.
But Brahm wants to do 3 times more than I do because he loves the work, and I don't. I don't want to get into nuts and bolts, but how does a socialist society handle us 2 guys? He's way overworking and I'm way underworking.
You see, you living in a capitalist society with a capitalist consciousness.
I have no desire to work. I just have
You live in a capitalist society with a capitalist consciousness. That's a capitalist consciousness. But when you have a different system and people are conditioned to do to do things in a completely different way, they don't think along those lines, and they won't think along those lines. It won't even occur to them. They'll just look at work as being a natural thing, like eating or sleeping. They won't even look at that.
Okay.
Well, yes, Pat?
Yeah, I realize that Russia, despite the USSR's middle name, socialist, I realize they never got to quite that level, but in their quest for socialism, did you not have in the Soviet Union among the world's highest rates of absenteeism on the job, among the world's highest rates of job-related accidents, and indeed in both the factories and in the military, undeniably one of the highest rates of alcoholism anywhere in the world? Now, is this the type of utopia that we can all look forward to going through on our route to social perfection?
Well, like I said before, Russia, the Soviet Union, was not controlled by workers. It was controlled by the Communist Party. Now, when you have the workers controlling a country, you wouldn't have all that. But what happened was you had a particular situation. Here you had one country in the world that had a revolution that is completely encircled by capitalism, completely encircled. And the level of production was very, very low. And they had to produce armaments in order to defend themselves. So the people never got to produce the things that they needed for just everyday life. And a lot of them became very disenchanted with that. But they had other things there. They had free schooling, the university level. They had free medicine. They had homes that they didn't pay much for. There was a lot of negative things, but there was more positive things than there were negative things. Now, what you just said comes out of the capitalist press for the most part. I'm not saying it isn't true, but what they've done is emphasize the negative over the positive. So you got that from the mass media that's controlled by capitalists. That's where you got that, and they never brought out the positive aspects. That's the trouble with them.
And the Anderson?
You've been brainwashed, Butler.
Sid.
Yeah, go ahead.
You mentioned, I got a question. If Scandinavian countries are capitalist, you know, like America's capitalist, why do workers in the Scandinavian countries get a living wage and a much higher standard of living than in America?
Well, in America, let's say before the war or after the war, there was about 33% of workers belonging to unions. And the conditions were a lot better. In the Scandinavian countries, I think it's Sweden or Norway or one of those countries, 85% are in unions. And when you have a union, you have clout. You have power in order to go against capital. So capital brings out some reforms, which is called social democracy, like we had under Roosevelt, in order for the workers not to revolt. And that's what done it, because there was pressure from below, because of union power.
And that's what happened in the Scandinavian
country? Yeah, that's what happened there.
Okay.
All right, Daniela.
So, I apologize. I have a cough. I can't talk too loud. But what you said to the gentleman about the media, I was born in Romania under Ceausescu.
Yeah.
And so really you can say the same thing about the media there. There are 2 hours of TV telling you how great it is that the fields are growing and everything's good, but nobody has food, nobody has stuff. So I think this whole idea of distortion through the media is not really the valid argument. It seems to me like what you're communicating somehow contradicts human nature, which is highly competitive. I agree with this gentleman that if you want to just sit around, you can do that in a socialist country, communist country. But I've also heard it argued that really the age of socialism was most manifest during high modernism in the Eastern Bloc. During high modernism in the Eastern Bloc, when Fordism was really accelerated and the economy was almost capitalistic, but that we are now entering a stage where we actually have to move to a much more almost like an anarchy, where there is free markets, there is less domination by the government, and there's a lot more sort of ground up, not socialism, but self-organized systems. And I'm just wondering if that's what you're calling socialism, or if you're...
No, like I said, what happened is you had so many distortions under socialism because the workers did not directly control things. It was the Communist Party that controlled it.
No, that I understand
okay.
that, but
so what happens is you get all these distortions in the economy and everything else. Plus, you're not bringing in the fact all these countries were surrounded by capitalist countries. Not only that, the United States had 250 bases surrounding the Soviet Union. So all their energy was put in arms, so they couldn't take care of their populace. As far as human nature is concerned, you ever read about primitive society? There was no competition under primitive society. They didn't know the word of competition.
But they were not organized on the scale that we are. They didn't,
no, it don't
they
matter. Human nature is malleable. It depends on the conditions of life. That conditions people how they think, how they behave, and their level of consciousness. And if you change the conditions of life, you can change consciousness. There's no such thing as human nature.
I think that's partially true, but very utopian. To assume that everybody will move in this idea.
No, that's a way of conditioning. You can condition people to do almost everything. If you got the communications, you got the schools, you got the churches, you got all means of propaganda on your side. You could condition people.
I have a second part to my earlier question, pro-communist. But now I'm going to bring out slavery compared to capitalism, which I have lived for 77 years of my life. And so I believe if I was a slave in ancient Greece, where I was born actually, or if I was a slave in America or in Rome, my slave owner would not be totally heartless and inhuman. He would let me stay on the plantation, he would let me stay in the village or wherever he needed me to be a slave, and when I got old, he would have food, shelter, a doctor for me, and I would die in dignity. Today, the free people who are actually slaves of capitalism are dying under the bridges. So they let you go out and die. So in other words, capitalism is even more inhuman than slavery. You agree?
Well, I know at the beginning, let's say mercantile capitalism. In mercantile capitalism, the merchants knew all his employees. And he knew all his employees by name. But nowadays, what you have is these big corporations, and they live in these high rises with air conditioning.
Camera.
They have no intercourse, social intercourse.
Maybe he didn't see my hand.
Wait a minute. What happened? Hey,
we're blocking
you. Standing in front of the camera.
Camera.
Okay. Well, like I was saying, there's no intercourse between social intercourse between a worker and the capitalist. Capitalists don't even know what a worker does or anything. And so there's no contact at all and no social intercourse. So That's all they look at is the bottom line. They don't care about people. They care about the bottom line. That's all they care about. They don't care whether you live or die. They don't even know if you live or die. As long as they can make a profit, they'll sell you poison if they can make a profit. Sure. And a lot of times they do.
Okay.
Cohen, when you started your speech, you mentioned, at least if I didn't listen, Jimmy, you were talking about somebody else. You mentioned Heraclitus.
Heraclitus, yeah.
Okay.
An ancient Roman materialist
philosopher. How does he fit into your narrative as it's going on?
Like I said, he said, the dry becomes moist, day becomes night. In other words, nothing stands still. Capitalism can't last forever. Capitalism developed into socialism. Things develop into its opposite. And they're constantly developing into the opposite. Capitalism once used to be progressive. Now, it's very reactionary. So it turned into its opposite. And things turn into its opposite after a while. No matter what you do, life turns into death. And death, turns into a new form of life. Flowers start coming up and things like that. So it's a part of the process of matter itself.
Okay.
Oh, yes, Involker.
All right. You know, I've often heard that the reason why capitalism doesn't work in a lot of these places is that because we don't have enough of it. The whole essence of capitalism is the documentation of assets and property to be turned into equity that can be turned into goods. And those goods are represented by people making things and building things. And they organize themselves under a company, and they cannot survive unless somebody buys their product.
Right.
I can't see a better system. What's wrong? Yeah,
the thing is, let's say somebody works for Walmart, or somebody works for another corporation. Let's say for McDonald's. They don't get enough to live on. So how are they going to buy back the product that are produced? Capital is run out of customers because it doesn't want to pay anything, because the profit margin becomes higher and higher, and that's what they're working for. Now, if a capitalist doesn't expand, he dies, because another capitalist will come in and take over.
Gross.
If the United States doesn't expand, Germany will take over, or England will take over. So that's what happens. There's constant competition between them. And either you expand, or you die.
It's called.
And that's what capitalism is.
And then aren't you just declaring what the bankruptcy thing does when a company goes under because it can't compete? Isn't that exactly what capitalism is supposed to do?
Yeah, then another company takes over and buys them up.
And isn't that a good thing?
The big fish swallow the small fish.
Charlie is chapping at the bit here.
No, I'm really. But Sid, in a capitalist system, isn't all work, thinking of Steve and Tim here, isn't all work under capitalism in order to make some guy rich?
Right, yeah, exactly.
So, if you have other kinds of work in which you make the community rich, then everyone would want to do that, right?
No, they can't. The main thing for a capitalist to do is...
Well, see, your own benefits.
Is make a higher profit than he did before.
No, I meant in the socialist work...
Yeah.
The work is for the community and everyone, including yourself, not
right,
for
right,
somebody
yeah.
else's gain.
Right, yeah. You're
so
right.
You would, it all work here is for the gain of another person.
Right.
And I don't blame anybody for not refusing to do it.
Well, that's why a lot of them get out of it.
You know, but Tim wants to do it. He wants to make some guy rich.
Well, nowadays
I don't
what
know
happens.
Why.
Well, nowadays what happens is you got a lot of women that used to work in the offices and everything, secretaries and this and that. Now we got robotics. And what happened is you got a proliferation of pornography. Because the women can't make a living, so they go in pornography. they find another profession, the oldest profession in the world.
Yeah, getting back to reality for a moment.
Oh, dear.
You spoke about the Soviet Union being forced to manufacture weapons because of the 250 American bases ringing the Soviet Union. Weren't those bases installed after World War II, after Russia had a bit of expansionist impulses and took over half of Europe? Poland, East Germany, Romania, Bulgaria. I can go on, but I think you get the idea. Wasn't it necessary to set up these bases to prevent the Soviet Union from gobbling up even more? You talk about the need to expand or die. Weren't they operating under that philosophy themselves?
No, what happened was you had World War II, and the Soviet Union was invaded by Germany, and it had a lot of arms. It had all the arms of Europe that it captured from these other countries that had overrun. Like, for instance, in Czechoslovakia, you had the Skoba Works, which is one of the largest industrial complexes in the world. They took that over, and the Soviet Union had a battle all through the point where they got into East Germany. So those countries were taken over because of the Second World War. But if you look at history, if you look at right after the Russian Revolution, something like 10 or 15 countries invaded the Soviet Union. And there was no aggression on the part of the Soviet Union. Under General Graves' expeditionary forces, you had Japan, and you have a lot of countries that invaded. So the United States invaded Russia way before that. And it wouldn't recognize Russia all through that period.
Didn't Russia invade her neighbors, Poland, Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia? They tried Finland.
Well, what happened with that is that they did invade those countries, but they knew that Hitler was going to invade them. So they wanted like a cordon sanitaire, as they used to call it, around the Soviet Union to protect themselves. That's what happened. But Finland actually was a fascist country.
I thought there was a Hitler-Stalin pact.
There was, yeah. That's the reason for it. Because they knew they were eventually going to be invaded by Germany.
Well, why was he in an alliance with Germany then?
They weren't in alliance with them.
They had that pact.
But they had the pact, but it was a temporary thing. In order to invade the
Hitler invaded it.
Yeah, it was a temporary thing.
I ask a question because my country, Greece, we had a lot of Nazi collaborators that went and joined the Nazis. And Romania, Bulgaria, Hungary, Czechoslovakia, Poland, Baltic states. There were millions and millions of pro-Nazis joined the Nazi Hitler to invade Russia. So that, I believe, might explain why when the Russians defeated single-handed, historically speaking, the Nazis, that's why they said, hey, these SOBs, they came and invaded us, they killed us, they burned our country.
Right.
Now we're going to occupy them for our protection.
Right.
And
exactly.
After 27 million dead, how much more do you want, proof do you want that they want to kill you?
You're right. You're 100% correct.
All right. Yes?
So help us out. I think Charlie and Pat were on
some
something.
You got some water?
Oh, yes.
Ow.
We still have some water. Did somebody bring, send some water? Thank you.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you,
Pat. So Charlie and Pat were on to something about what country, how about this question, what country is close to your ideal socialism. Is there any country that's close to it, maybe 5 years off, or living the dream that you guys have as socialists?
Well, I would say actually Cuba would come the closest, but Cuba can't have trade with the United States and has to spend tremendous sums of money to have trade with somebody else. And the United States is this natural trader because it's so close. So they have to spend so much extra capital in order to trade with other countries. And they have to borrow and so forth. But I would say it's the most socialistic country of all the countries.
Cuba and who else? I think you mentioned, didn't you mention one other country that was close?
Well, China's moving in that direction.
Huh.
It's moving in that direction. I don't say it's there.
Huh.
All right, Ileana. Eliana, you weren't waving your hand, though. Okay.
Pat Butler.
Yes. Pat Butler,
yeah.
And then Charlie.
What is your argument going to be next year when trade with Cuba will be fully restored? We're this close to doing it right now, and Cuba will no longer have that excuse because the United States is now more than happy to deal with the Cubans, and so doesn't that deflate one of your arguments?
No, because actually it didn't come out with any trade so far, nothing at all. It has relations with Cuba, which is a bare beginning, but does not come out with trade as yet. The United States has not gone that far.
So then as a corollary, what do you expect about they already opened up trade with this new company that's booking rooms online for tourists and B&Bs. I forget what their name is, but they've already made a lot of business just already by booking rooms with Cubans.
Well, that's good, I think. Actually, Cuba uses a lot of its wealth on its own people because it has free schooling, free health, and so forth and so on. And the people are pretty well protected, but of course they don't have the industrial capacity, and they don't have the capital to invest in a lot of things. So if they get a lot of tourists in there and they get trade, they'll have the capital to invest in their economy and build up their economy, and we'll see what happens. But generally speaking, the tide of history usually flows progressively toward advances.
Charlie Pedro.
Yeah, Sid, do you think socialism in the United States can be achieved through the legislative process, or will it be necessary to take more stringent efforts and arrest the 1% and guys like Butler and put them to work on the people's interstate?
Well, we never know what's going to happen in the future. Hopefully what I believe is that a lot of countries are going to go socialist and the United States be caught in a trap. Either it develops towards socialism or we'll have to start a war. So what could happen in that type of situation, what I would do is say to the capitalists, listen, you can live the way you are now, not quite as opulent, but you can pass on your wealth to your offsprings. And if you give up your capitalist belongings, you could do that. And maybe they'll succeed. We don't know. Hopefully it could be peacefully done. I don't know.
Yeah.
Rose Cole, and then Dan Weinberg. Rose? Yes. I was going to ask what the case for the inevitability of socialism looks current, but you just answered that question by saying it's not inevitable.
Well, a number of things could happen. One, we have global warming that could destroy the Earth and destroy all life on Earth. Another thing is we have atomic and hydrogen bombs, which also could destroy the Earth. So either the earth will be destroyed, or we're going to progress into socialism. But nobody could foretell that. It's nothing that's in the books or anything. This has to be worked on by people themselves. There's no way of knowing that. But hopefully, I think that the world will be safe.
I didn't hear, I don't know if you said anything about Social Security. Did you call Social Security somebody?
Social Security is a way of protecting capital. They threw you a few crumbs so you wouldn't overthrow the system. That's what Roosevelt did under the New Deal.
So
It's progress. I don't say this. It's definitely progress. But the only thing, the reason they gave it to people is because they thought the system would be overthrown. A lot of people were on strikes. They were occupying factories. There were demonstrations all over. And Roosevelt thought there would be a revolution if things go on the way they were. So he threw the workers a few crumbs by giving them these New Deal reforms. And that's what Social Security was.
All right, Mike Lehman.
And in fact, in Social Security, at that particular time, you wouldn't even live to see your Social Security because people would die at an early age. So you really didn't give you much. But now people are living very long. I'm 87 years old.
Okay.
Hey, Michael, Sid, what do we do about the 1% problem?
Well, you have to get rid of them.
No.
Maybe you don't have to work world's wealth.
No.
What do we do?
Well, if you have a socialist revolution, all their wealth will be confiscated.
Is there another option?
That's the only way. You can't even have it.
You think we're like just days away from the...
No. People's consciousness.
Like a union revolt across the country?
No. The United States is very backward. It's very backward socially. It has no level of class consciousness, hardly at all.
We've been you on.
Yeah, but this year, it's a democratic country at least. 99% supposed to be able to elect good people to change the system. Is that possible, or just why is just not enough education or experience of the 99% of the people?
Well, people have been miseducated. They don't even know what's happening. If you ask any person on the street and say, who controls this country? They say the people do. They vote in the Republican and Democratic primaries. And then we vote for our president. We vote for our mayor. But who controls the wealth of the country? It's the 1%.
There's no people. There's 300 million vegetables. I know, because I'm one of them.
Bravo! That we can agree with.
You're all vegetables.
In whose case, that's something I can agree with.
Question or what? She knows cold, yes.
What are the chances of a successful revolution considering that the state has, even if no one joined their armies, they have these drones that can operate against robots and against the masses?
Look what happened in Vietnam. The United States had the most mechanized army in the world. And here's a third-rate country, a primitive country, that had hardly any industry, defeating a first-rate power. So no matter what type of technology they have, people could find a way to defeat them. Unless, of course, they drop the atom bomb, an atomic bomb. But then they'll destroy everything on the earth. Won't make no difference.
Butler?
Yeah, you mentioned Vietnam. Wasn't the war in Vietnam lost, if you will, not because of the fact that the most mechanized army in the world was defeated in the field, but because of the fact that you had a number of amateur generals, Lyndon Johnson among them, who were hamstringing the people that were trying to, for good or for ill, that were trying to get that war done. How much interference by the politicians in Washington prolonged that war unnecessarily?
Well, for one thing, we have to look at the Vietnamese people themselves. They had a lot of energy and a lot of, like I would say, lust for freedom. And they didn't want to be occupied by foreign powers like the French, the Americans, or any other imperialist power. And they were able to devise strategies in order to defeat a first-rate power. So it wasn't generals or colonels or strategists that lost the war. The American people didn't want to fight in the war and didn't have no morale to fight in the war, where the Vietnamese wanted their freedom. That's what won the war, not generals and colonels and strategists.
Follow up, if I may. Is it not a fact that a lot of people down through the pages of history have strongly, strongly lusted for their freedom and were constantly defeated over periods of hundreds of years because of the fact that they were beaten by superior forces and they were beaten by forces which had far more resources than they did? I could use a few examples, but I won't. I think we all know which countries have gone through that kind of thing over the centuries.
Well, every country and every situation is unique. We can't compare what happened in Rome and the people that fought against Rome to the people that fought in the United States. Tactics change, armaments change, consciousness change. So there's a whole lot of different entities that go into fighting a war. And we can't compare one to another. It's completely different. You have to look at facts on the ground and at a particular time when it happened in order to understand it.
Oh, that's cool.
All right,
yes.
Just kind of related to the last conversation that we had. So. Let's say we're going through this phase of changing over to socialism. I think what you say is that we have to kind of recondition our consciousness.
I have one or two.
But I also heard you say that you need a kind of control mechanism to do that. You can't, something has to be in place, a government, a police, something to kind of enforce that, because I think there is really a human nature that's very diverse. So my human nature may be different than yours. Sure it is. And that's pervasive. So what kind of control mechanism would make that happen?
Well, the control mechanism would be the people themselves, the workers, participating in all phases of that particular...
What makes them want to participate in all this?
Well, they would, let's say, they would overlook the plans that were made in order to industrialize that particular plant. They would take part in discussions about what should be done, how this machinery doesn't work or that machinery doesn't work. They would participate in all different phases in that society. And that what that would do is condition their consciousness in a completely different reaction, in a different situation than
but
we have
not
today.
Not necessarily converging towards one goal.
Yeah, it would be converging towards a goal. And that is the people themselves should run the economy, run the administration of things, because in socialism you wouldn't really have a government per se, you would have an administration of things. And people would participate in that in an everyday level. So their consciousness would be completely different. It would be a revolution in consciousness, because there'd be a revolution in action. And that's what materialism is.
Unfortunately, I have a question myself, and that is, the advocates of certain forms of Marxism, particularly Marxism, Leninism, Stalinism, have dwelt very heavily on the inevitability. And Marx is to blame for this. He did talk about his socialism as being scientific and based on laws of material history. And he occasionally talked about some sort of inevitabilities. But as you say, it isn't inevitable. So is it worth clarifying the dialectical materialism of Marxism somewhat so that we don't think of it as inevitable?
Well, he looked at laws, its tendencies. Yeah. And by tendencies, let me just finish.
As laws.
Yeah, no. What he meant by tendencies is you have a system that there's a private appropriation, but social production. In other words, people produce socially, but the capitalist exploits these people. Yeah. So, what was your question? My chain of thought.
Yeah. Well, I've just been reading Aronson's little book. He was a former
He didn't say it was inevitable. He said there was a tendency towards that. And now we could see what is happening in the world. You have global warming that could destroy the planet. You have perpetual wars. You have insecurity to such a level that if we don't change, human beings will pass from this earth like all species. So if we don't change, we'll be the end of the human race. Either we change or don't change. And that is the question, really. And there is no other question.
Gentleman in the corner
asked
a question.
Okay.
Yes, Mike Weiner. Yeah, I just want to ask. So what is the big contradiction within capitalism that makes it necessary to go forward to a new stage of development?
Well, we have exploitation of labor. It's the basic law of capitalism.
It's not the basic.
And exploitation has become so bad that people can't live any longer under this system. And either we change it, or like I said, we won't have no society at all. There has to be a change. And that is so obvious to people that understand what's happening. But what happens is you put on the capitalist press, or you read the newspaper, they don't talk about it. They don't say anything about it. That either we change, or that's the end of human life. So. That's the main contradiction.
All right.
Let's see. It's the same hand.
Yeah. Rom, we ought to get the rebuttals.
We're thinking.
All right.
Maybe from that side.
Going from the back forward, Charlie Paydoff.
Yeah, you're belly aching about the 1%ers all the time. But isn't it true that everyone today has significantly more than they had in the Middle Ages? And we all have a pretty good lifestyle.
Not really?
Well,
the Middle Ages was pretty bad. But just look at the difference between the wealth in the Middle Ages and the wealth now. And the wealth now could support everybody on this earth with a decent wage and a decent living. But in the Middle Ages, they can never do that. That's the big difference.
Okay.
All right, Pat?
Yeah, how would you go about bringing this, you talked about this change that's necessary, how would you go about bringing this? Are you hoping to re-educate the entire population, or do you advocate, as Clausewitz put it, diplomacy by other means?
Well, what is happening now, like I said, the contradictions have become so acute. And the consciousness does not come from the workers themselves. It's usually brought to the workers by educated classes. If you look at all these revolutions and all these revolutionaries, you'll find that almost all of them come from the middle classes. They don't come from the working classes. Like you take Marx himself, you take Castro, you take Ho Chi Minh, you take almost any of these leaders. Consciousness comes from a set of people that understand what's going on, and eventually, through propaganda, through the struggle of the workers with capitalists, it'll eventually come to their consciousness that the system has to be changed. How this will be done exactly, nobody knows. I'm not a fortune teller. Nobody's a fortune teller. Nobody can tell exactly how it will happen. Nobody.
All right. So Danielle brought about a question about human nature. And I just want to, once again, I don't want to go nuts and bolts, but you mentioned two different things. One is you got to get the propaganda out there so we all can get on board. So somebody has to control that. And then you have to have an administrative group, administrative government. You don't want to call it a government, just administrative group. So these two groups have a lot of power, baby. And I'm going to tell you what, if I'm in one of these two groups, I want to stay here. I want to stay in power. I don't want to be one of the workers that are getting educated. I want to do the educating, because that's my nature. I want to educate and I want to keep the power. And if I'm in the administration, I'm not calling government, if I'm in administration, I also have a little more power than the average person. So how can you keep me in check? How can socialism keep guys like me in check with my human nature?
There is no such thing as human nature. People are very malleable. For instance, if you look at feudalism, the monarchy and the aristocracy thought they could keep power forever. But it didn't happen. A new class arose, the capitalists, and took it over from them. Just like the workers could take over power from the capitalists.
It's going out.
It happened a lot of times. This is nothing new.
Okay.
As far as human nature, there is no such thing.
All right.
You could, when people are involved in everyday life, that is, they're doing the planning themselves. They're doing the producing themselves. They're doing the governing themselves. A new consciousness will arise because of those material conditions have been changed. And the consciousness will no longer be a capitalist consciousness, like you just said. It will be a socialist consciousness. And they realize that if everybody is doing good,
right,
why do we need power for one person? It doesn't make sense.
So there won't be guys like me. There won't be guys like me.
You'll be dead.
I'll be dead, yeah.
Daniela, and then Rose.
All right, then we got to go to rebuttals after that, Brahm.
We are getting pretty close.
So three more questions and we go to rebuttals.
All right, Andy. Yeah, look into the future. Do you think things will get better for the human race, or will our condition improve or degrade as we have more interaction with the other four civilizations that are sharing the planet with us?
Well, it depends on what happens in the economic level. For instance, if we go into a deep depression, which we might go into, people's consciousness will no longer be the same. They say we can't live this like this no longer. We have to change. And change is inevitable in everything. There's no such thing as something standing still. Matter itself, change is inherent in matter itself. And matter is a social form, is in our economic system. In capitalism, that's a social form, which is a form of matter.
Okay, there were two more questions.
Daniela?
Yeah, me again. Okay, so I'll use Marx's tendencies instead of human nature. And I'm going to argue that in every generation, in every country, throughout history, in every stage of history, certain tendencies arise, whether it's in me, you, that other person, charity, power, evil, good, whatever you want to call it, those tendencies exist in the population. So this idea that a consciousness can form a homogeneity does not sound plausible, even according to Marx. Because in Marx's philosophy, there are always contradictions in nature.
For one thing, you're making it all a psychological thing.
Well, but I think
what you're doing is that, but I'm talking about a material thing. In other words, when you have material changes,
but
your consciousness, let me finish. Your consciousness will begin to change. And you have a capitalist consciousness. That's what you have. You're brought up in this type of society. And your conditioning is along those lines. And you believe it's human nature. It's not human nature.
But I was not
societies, in primitive societies, nobody thought along those lines. I want power. They didn't even think along those lines. If somebody gave you, let's say, a particular thing, like he had a weapon, like a bow and arrow, to kill an animal for food, he wouldn't think, oh, this is mine, it has to belong to me, and this is my possession. They didn't think like that. They thought along the lines, listen, we have to have food, we all have to work together to hunt. So if you don't use my bow, somebody else can use it.
All right.
Rose Cole?
Yeah,
same thing as your wife.
Capitalism is individualistic materialism. Communism is
anti-individualism.
And you talked about behaviorism. People are brainwashed.
Well, there's two types of philosophy. And there's different forms of these philosophies. One is materialism, which I talk about. The other one is idealism, which means everything takes place in the brain.
Well, there's also existentialism, which acknowledges both the material and the spiritual.
But there is, actually, nobody could prove that the mind or the brain or the consciousness determines your lifestyle.
Okay.
What determines your lifestyle is the way you live. And your consciousness is a condition by the way you live. And you're conditioned by the way you live to think in a certain way. Now, if you were brought up in a different type of society that had a materialist philosophy, you wouldn't think along those lines. As far as consciousness is concerned, we need consciousness in order to understand what's going on so we can make choices. So we need consciousness.
Okay.
That is part of the process of learning. But then we have to practice what we learn. We have to put it into practice. By putting it into practice, we see what works and doesn't work. If it works, our consciousness are changed. Therefore, we do such and such thing and we can change things. If it doesn't work, then we look for something else that works.
What happened to innate human potential?
There is no human potential exactly. It's conditions around you that's put you in position. Either you live like this or you gotta change. Because things are happening, if you don't change, something negative will happen. So you change because there's pressure on you to change. It has nothing to do with your consciousness. People change
because they have to change. Let's say somebody smokes and they go to the doctor. The doctor says, either you stop smoking or you'll die. So that person begins to stop smoking and his consciousness eventually is going to change.
Okay. Rebuttals now. Okay. We're on the rebuttals, right?
Oh, yeah.
How many here have rebuttal remarks to make? One, two, three.
I'm going to start the clock.
Butley, you're going to have to eat me a 10 years.
All right.
On the People's Interstate. And
for me tonight,
boom.
I have never heard a bunch of what we call male bovine fecal matter in quite a while.
Oh.
Male bovine fecal matter, because the socialism, as it's there, is another theoretical goofy way of another stinking way to change the world. Just like communism was, now we're seeing the same way Islamic fundamentalism and the caliphate is. The bottom line is this: free markets work. People, when they work and they own things and they produce, work together. Here's why you have poor nations and poor people.
Why?
It's because, Charlie, the poor in those nations don't have adequate documentation of their assets to bring their capital to work. In the West, in the United States, every building, every piece of property, everything you can think of is documented somewhere and can be monetized or put into some form of liquid asset. Most of the capital that's designed to start small businesses today comes from the home mortgage of entrepreneurs. You can't do that in a lot of foreign countries because the rights of land ownership, documentations of everything else, does not work. The first thing we did after World War II for Japan was register the property, take the ownership into the actual hands where it was done, and look what happened to Japan. Almost virtually overnight, they became a prosperous country. 5/6 of the humanity in the world do not have adequate documentation of their property rights in order to make the capitalistic system work. And when it does work, it works well. Over the last 300 years, we have seen people come out of this so-called socialist utopia of the peasant farmer, move into cities, get better jobs. If you think that anybody would want to be a peasant farmer under the socialistic revolution, you got another thing coming.
I'd rather be in a factory in Bangladesh.
You know, Charlie, the factories in Bangladesh develop into other businesses, into other places, into bigger, better ways of doing things. And we are seeing today a lot more progress under market capitalism, and even including your unions. They represent workers because, yes, there is injustice in the system, but that's why you have politics. That's why you have government. I am not saying for unrestrained, unregulated monopolies. I'm for competition. I'm for the creative destruction of old businesses, the formation of new ones, the constant change and turmoil that Sid talks about. Yes, I agree, we need a revolution, but not a revolution as Sid proclaims, a real revolution of capitalism where property rights are recognized by third world countries, where people can actually monetize their assets, start businesses, and actually start making a living by what they own already own and market.
Yeah.
Yes.
All right.
I don't know.
Get it. Get it there, Jim. Get it. Get it, brother.
Mike, hey, Mike.
Way to go, way to go. Fire him up, brother. Fire him up.
Have a nice holiday.
Oh, boy.
All right, one more of the Tigers.
All right. I think a lot of accountants will get the world straightened out, though.
Marine Corps is looking for you.
And maybe we can expand the IRS around the globe. Anyway, what I learned in Economics 102.
Oh, right.
You know, microeconomics is 101. Macro, the world, is 102. Okay. Anyway, so you got the government, you got the unions, and you got the corporations. Those are the three money handlers. But anyway, we need, obviously with globalization and, you know, de-unionization, we need better unions and more unions to lift up the people, and I think it's the government's duty. And I think, you know, I think things are growing around the country here that wages have to go up dramatically. So anyway, that's my point on economics there, 102. And then another thing that I mentioned last week was that, the Great Recession, we just got to experience that the last 6 or 7 years. And I was just fascinated, I'll mention it again, that as much money was spent on getting us out of the Great Recession as was in the Great Depression. In, you know, similar dollars, the 1930 dollars to the present. So, like I mentioned last week or two ago, that in the 1930s we had works programs, we built libraries and bridges and all kinds of infrastructure and things like that, something to show from it. And if you go around town in Chicago, you'll see that. But unfortunately, the stimulus programs and the TARPs and the all that went to Wall Street. So if you're a big, you know, portfolio holder or Wall Street broker or banker the last 6 or 7 years, you know, you're 1% and 10%, your portfolios have exploded. You know, that's, you just got more money than you can ever imagine. So we made all those people very, very rich the last 7 years, versus like in the 1930s where people thought things through better. We had, you know, better jobs and built things. So redistribution now, redistribution tomorrow, redistribution forever. More taxes for 1%.
All right, Mike. Great deal, buddy.
You guys, some cabinets. Go back to Moscow. Never
Russia. Cohen, you did a nice job.
Okay, go.
This is 2 weeks in a row. It's 2 weeks in a row. You come here and you answer the question because you want knowledge about what you're talking about. You did a hell of a job. Last week, Don spoke and he did an intelligent, nice job. So thank goodness you don't get that kind of intelligent often.
Especially
here. The gentleman here, the tall gentleman, he spoke here a few times, and I remember. If I did anything that seemed disrespectful, it ain't me. Okay? I want to apologize when you came over.
No problem.
Yeah. But sometimes, if a flea bites you, you might hit with a flea bite, right? Well, if I come in here and pay my money and hold my hand up, 2 or 3 times,
okay,
and get passed over for 9 other people.
Yeah, that's
fine. I got to hit up, you know. But that ain't me.
I knew that part.
That ain't
time,
me.
But
I got a old saying, excuse the language. I wasn't no asshole when I met you, and you ain't gonna turn me into one. Okay, now, let me, you mentioned Heraclitus,
and that kind of rang the bell with me, because that's where I started with the pre-Socratics, Heraclitus, Thales, Democritus, Christus, and others, Parmenides. These are contemporary of one another, and if they weren't contemporary, they knew and had familiar with each one of them, one another's work. Now, I mentioned this because it was mentioned in the speech, and I'm saying I don't see nobody too often that ranks intellectual with these type of people. I done wrestled with Kant and Hegel and Nietzsche, and I done stood in taverns and talked with people. I done come to the college complex. Ain't too many people equal these when they get to talking. Why? Because they don't know how. Logic is the first lesson in philosophy. And arguments is a form of structure. It ain't just somebody run off at the mouth, or two people talking loud, over talking and interrupting one another, or somebody talking just to be heard. It's about something. It ain't nothing. It ain't got nothing to do with me. It got something to do with this subject, what they talking about. And there's no end to that. That's another reason I lack philosophy. There ain't no philosophy come out, well, I got this, is this what we do? I got this and that. No, no. It's ongoing. Ain't no human being got no answer. Ain't no human being got shit. Because if he did, he would stay out of Rose Hill Cemetery or any other cemetery. So he must not know everything, and he should act like that. Philosophers don't pull guns on one another. They didn't get up and call one another's name. They kept the dialogue going. And that's all you can do. And that's what I love about philosophy. And I love the argument because it sticks to the structure of logic and so forth. So Parmenides and Democritus, and they talked about everything. I don't know nothing in philosophy that, I don't know nothing we know that they didn't talk about in philosophy. Whether it had something to do with Mars, whether it had something to do with how the earth begins. These were pre-Socratics, they called them. That was before Plato and Aristotle. And they were talking about Democritus was talking about Adam. Even then, he was talking about Adam. They were talking about how the world began, and how this and what was important and so forth. These are people that was talking intelligent, that knew how to talk intelligent, and wasn't trying to talk about, look at me, and oh, I got this, because you ain't got nothing if you're on your way to Rose Hill Cemetery.
All right.
All right, Gene.
All right.
Gene. Okay, thanks, Sid. Andy Anderson has mentioned this book a couple times. I'm reading it now. I'm only a third of the way through. It's a terrible book to read. I wouldn't suggest it. But if you're a libertarian or capitalist, do not read this book. This Changes Everything by Naomi Klein. It just confirms what Sid has said. So take a look at that if you think you can stand it. My intent is to finish that book, even though it's a terribly hard book. I heard something said that I perceived as a positive comment on American slavery. While I was sitting there, I figured that I had read 5 books on American slavery. I'm not an academician, but I read 5 books on this. I've seen 3 DVD sets on this.
See you guys next week.
And believe me, there's nothing good about American slavery. And if you think, since most of the people, not all, but most of the people in the room appear to be, like me, white, if you think it just hurt black people, think again. It's just absolutely terrible. I'm not going to go into detail. And don't read these if you tend toward depression. Thank you.
All right.
Yeah, thank you for the speaker. From my point of view, my definition of socialism and capitalism maybe a little bit different from yours, but let me say, to me, these are two, say, extreme end, okay? Socialism is not dealing with money, and it's just people give favors to each other. But capitalism is everything based on money and transactions and property rights, as Tim mentioned. So socialism, a pure socialism, maybe in a family, say in my family, okay, at least my money and my wife's money are exchangeable. We don't have individual accounts, and certainly when we give something to my kids, I don't ask them to pay me money, and so everything is socialism. But sometimes I do have, say, this toy is yours, that thing is my wife's, but it's, I can say that it's nothing else. So there's a structure in the socialism definition. There's a leader, and there's a structure in the system. So if you become a big socialism society, maybe a church is somewhat socialism, or it becomes a society, a country, then the structure maybe becomes a very authoritarianism and maybe a dictatorship at the top. So I think like communist, they are that kind of socialism. Once it becomes very big, it has its problems. They distribute the wealth not based on the on how much you work. It's based on what's your relationship in the society, what's your status in the society. So it's not very fair. And one at the end, it's the Communist Party. They want to keep their power. There's no change. So the society is like, you can say, stable, but actually it's very behind. All the industry and the society is to today's modern society is very 30, 40 years behind, like in Korea and the Cuba. Did I mention Cuba? So that's the problem when it grows up. Capitalism is similar. Tim mentioned the property rights. That's the basic capitalism. It's good. It's a good thing if you implement it fairly. But that creates a motivation for everybody to compete, to get more property, to get rich, to get improved, the whole society get improved. So it, when the problem comes, when it grows bigger, the rich gets richer, because when you become rich, you can make more money easier than when you are poor. It's just like a play Monopoly. At the end, halfway through, you probably knows if you are losing at the beginning, you probably won't make at the end. So that's the problem with capitalism. At the beginning, it's good, rapid change, and then create proper prosperity. But once controlled by a few people, a few big corporations, and then they tend to lock down the system. They try to keep their fortune there to give their sons or daughters or grandsons. Then the system becomes really bad. I just went to a talk day before yesterday about Mexico. They say Mexico has the world one or two richest people, one of the richest people, but the system there is really corrupted with crime organizations. So USA, it's moving in that way, so we want to change. So at the end, I think a lively society is a society keep changing and keep evolving. A dark society is a society is steady, is controlled by party, controlled by a few rich, 1%, or controlled by church, like in the dark medieval time.
Okay, your time's up.
So, thank you for the speaker. I agree with change. Society is the most important.
Yeah. All right, please.
The guy from Mexico is Carlos Smith.
All right.
What? The rich guy from Mexico is Carlos Smith.
Pat Butler.
One of the reasons that I asked our speaker tonight what he thought was going to come after socialism or some form thereof, I had a reason for that because, yes, it's true. Systems change, they evolve, and despite enough talk earlier in the evening about how death is necessary in order to achieve fuller life. I thought I was at a funeral or in a seminary class at Mundelein. I wasn't sure which. But the fact of the matter is, yes, things do change. Personally, if I were to look into a crystal ball and to see what would be the best possible outcome, personally, I would like to see a combination of the New Deal carried out on a much larger scale, and a mixture of some form of benign socialism. However, we're probably not going to have that happen. We're probably not going to have that happen because of the fact that, unfortunately, socialism means as many different things as there are people in this room. In Europe, socialism is a perfectly respectable concept. The socialist parties in Europe are in some cases the dominant parties in Europe. They're not communist. They're not totalitarian. They operate in some ways like the Democratic Party or its equivalent in some countries have operated. Share the wealth, but don't take it all. That kind of thing. We're going to have to think creatively. We're going to have to think in terms of everyone walking away from the table a winner, or at least a partial winner. Now, I was when I was at Lerner Newspapers, I was for a time the chairman of the union at part of the Lerner Newspapers. And I helped negotiate contracts. And one of the things I always tried to do was make sure that we, the workers, and they, the management, were able to walk away from the table with something so that they could come away partially happy.
Yeah.
And I think that's the way we have to approach this. We can't, as our speaker pointed out, and I disagreed vehemently with a lot of what he said, but as our speaker pointed out, we do have to make changes. We do have to evolve. The question is whether we find it necessary to evolve and ape the thinking of Lenin or Marx, or whether we find ourselves capable of evolving in a whole different, more original direction. Personally, my heroes are not the foreign heroes of Marx, Lenin, and such, but Franklin D. Roosevelt and Teddy Roosevelt. Both of those people laid the groundwork for a society very different from the one that we had at the beginning of the 20th century. We can make constructive changes. We can turn this society into something that is even more beneficial to everyone. But we can't do it by aping and listening to the tired old propaganda that emanated from the Soviet Union. And I am not a red baiter, but I must admit that I chortle a little bit when you have a speaker who said the Soviet Union found it necessary to arm themselves to the teeth because of the 250 U.S. bases around Russia. Consider why those bases were put there. Look back in 1945 and look at what happened in Poland, in Lithuania, in Latvia, in Estonia, in Hungary, in half of Austria, in half of Germany. Those countries did not voluntarily decide to go under the Russian yoke. What we had was not the spread of communism, but the spread of old-fashioned Russian imperialism. They do it all the time. We're seeing it now with Putin. You know, it's the same old story, and we've got to contend with that. We've got to trust them to be what they are. They're going to grab as much as they can. And until someone stands up and says this far and no further, and remember the Germans, before World War II, were saying that they needed certain territories in order to protect themselves from the Russians, from the British, from the French. And that was the argument they used for taking Czechoslovakia, for taking part of Poland, for taking a number of other countries, Netherlands, Belgium, Luxembourg, part of France, and it went on and on and on. We here at the College of Complexes have at times been exposed to enough BS. We ought to know it when we see it. At least
yeah.
We ought to be able to
tell it.
We just heard it.
Well, I just have to say on that note that Trump hobbled the Soviet Union in the 1940s would have been disastrous. So, in other words, there would have been Nazism throughout Europe if you're going to hobble the Soviet Union. So if the proof is in the pudding, you know, that's all I need to say about that. But nice talk about society being a type of matter, social matter. Yeah, that's a hard concept to wrap one's brain around. I think maybe, I'm not sure, I have to do some research on that, but I think that comes from Hegel's logic, using examples from physical matter. But when you use dialectical logic, that same logic that you're using to analyze physical matter suits you just perfectly when you're trying to understand what makes society work. And if anyone proved that, it was Marx, but before him, David Ricardo, also a political economist, as they call them, was really the one that predicted, or not predicted, but recognized the trend that capitalism would be going downhill as far as the standard of life for working people was concerned. Ricardo said basically, but what are you going to do about it? And Marx says, there is something we can do about it. We can go ahead to the next society. Like I said, Roebling, the inventor of the suspension bridge, applied Hegel's logic to solving that problem. The methodology that the engineers used, for example, during the Civil War, was to build a bridge as rigidly, to make it as rigid a structure as possible. And those bridges didn't last long. Roebling saw the need for not a rigid structure, but a system. That's the application of dialectical logic to solving an engineering problem. And in many ways, the skyscraper is a suspension bridge turned horizontal. It's a system, it has flexibility. And all you need to do is to have gone up to the signature room of the Hancock building before they removed the chandeliers. You'd see the chandeliers swaying on a windy day, and before they took out the stoppers in the sinks in the restrooms, and you filled the basin and you saw the water slashing, and people got sick from that, so they removed the chandeliers and the stoppers. Einstein applied dialectical logic to solving the problems of, he saw contradictions, observations. How do you reconcile the observations that were being made with the previous understanding of space, time, and with other observations? And people said, well, there's no way we can solve those contradictions. You know, it's just that's God at work. And he says, no, there's a way that we people, we can solve those problems. And like I say, Darwin applied dialectical logic to the biological sciences. Marx applied dialectical logic to the social sciences. He was very adept at seeing developments and tendencies, as Sid very ably pointed out. But as far as what the contradiction was, and still is, as far as his dialectical materialism, it was really from my understanding that, you have socialized production. And what does that mean? It means people getting together. I gave a talk once where a rebuttal or a question had to do with, it was from an individualist. And he says he makes his own boats. And I said, what do you mean you make your own boats? He says, I assemble them. I says, okay, do you use tools? Yeah. Okay, use a saw? Yeah, okay, that's that metal in that saw. I says, did you mine the ore that was used to make the iron from which the steel was made to make the blade of that saw? Well, no, you know. That hammer, did you do anything similar with the hammer? No, that was done by other people. And so there's no such thing as individualist production, you know, as much as a survivalist or an individualist might want to say that there is. And so you have this contradiction. You have socialized production, but you have private ownership of the means of production. And so when you have, they sometimes call it thesis and antithesis, and you have that both, that's a way of saying what's contradictory. You have the thesis of socialized production, and you have the antithesis, which is private ownership. And how do you reconcile that? You don't reconcile. It's not reconciled like you meld socialism and capitalism, and you have something of each. You reconcile that contradiction by socializing ownership to make all of us the owners. At least us working people, make us the owners of the means of producing goods and services and distributing them. So, but a really good talk, and especially guarding against the mechanistic approach that you see with some people's very crude explanations of dialectical materialism and dialectical logic. That is something that people fall
time?
Into.
Yes.
Okay. So well done, Sid.
All right. I'll be real quick. Say, let's thank our speaker again for literally on the money and for your contribution and attendance over the years to the college complexes. You're certainly one of, if not our senior member. I'll be eclectic as usual here. Mike, this rebuttal is entirely my production, but I will share it with the rest of you. That's because I choose to. Let's see here. There's a thing called the intellectual history of the world. Sid hit it on it a little bit. There were these guys, they were actually called the pre-Socratic philosophers. They were before Socrates. And they had all sorts, the Greeks were wondering all about the universe. And what is the world, they asked themselves. And they had all sorts of explanations. Well, the one that sort of succeeded was Aristotle, and later the Christian church. And the world was static, and it didn't change. And all the animals were made at once, and that's all the animals there were in the world. And the only change in the world were the seasons. People didn't even, and about the only event that they anticipated was the second coming, the end of the world, in Revelation. And so the world was put like a mechanism. It was put into operation like a clock that just kept going and going and going. Once it was, it worked perfectly.
That's what they said, the planets. There was a music, a harmony to nature, things like this. Now along come some guys, and they come up, let's just jump way ahead, and they said, no. The world is a process of change, and we're calling it this dialectical materialism. It's a fancy term. Basically, you never explained it. There's a thesis, an antithesis, and then there's a synthesis, and then it begins again. They said this was actually history. You're right. It was Hegel started out. Thesis, antithesis, synthesis. And it keeps going on and on and on. And they said there's a steady change. And if you want, other guys came along and they used a fancy term. They called this teleological, meaning it was like an end point, an omega point, some people called it. That there was a thrust to history. It wasn't just an unchanging world. But anyhow, that's where it was. And another thing, I'll switch all together. You were having a problem here about, well, I don't want to work, and something like things like this. The real problem is, capitalism, look at this society in terms of all the relationships. Marx wrote about this. In a capitalist society, what are the relationships? The only relationship is how much I can get from you at the least cost. And in a communist society, it's just there. They said you will be a good person if all your relationships are good. If you're in a sharing economy where you're not competing, competition society. But if you're in a society where everyone is just competing, what they could get as much as you can. Now, Tim, don't go away. He gave the example there. Oh, how wonderful it was in Japan, where they suddenly divided up all the property and gave everybody rights or deeds, I guess, and he thought this was a wonderful situation. And you mentioned the Monopoly game. Well, if you begin the game of Monopoly, what do? Just like that, they give everybody so much money, right?
Right.
Right. You know what they do when the Chuck plays Monopoly?
What?
All the money is together in the center. And we don't divvy it up like that. Because we share the money. And then we use that money for the good of the larger society. All right? We don't do like that, like where there's winners and losers, right? In your version of the game, right?
Well, that's
there's one winner, and right, everyone else loses, right?
That's Monopoly.
Is that the game you want? Do you want Chuck's game, where everybody wins, or his game? Thank you.
All right, next.
And you, wait a minute, what's all this? What's this Russia stuff? Boy, we're gonna all come. Russia's out to get us.
It's certainly evident with
that. Evidently, they got us.
The evil empire will get you. Those commies are coming.
You have to have a boogeyman.
Yeah, the boogeyman.
Sure.
Right here in the United States, we've got a few little problems, one of them, which figured somewhat in the recent election. Then there's all those undocumented aliens and all those people who are knocking on the door to get into this paradise here in this country, or at least to escape from the non-paradises that they are coming from. Those are a few little problems. Then there are problems that women have with the discrimination and for that matter, men have it too. Discrimination in employment. A guy trying to become a nurse will sometimes be discriminated against, even though men have been nurses before, and are now. But you do. There are stereotypes and all sorts of problems, social problems, economic problems. When you want to change society, when you want to change the relations of production and distribution and social relationships, you have to know what those conditions and tendencies and the forces are. And that's a matter of material, history, technology. You have to know these things to effectively work on them. And Karl Marx was for scientific socialism. He was emphasized that, you know, the people with good ideas, there were people like Robert Owen, who was a successful capitalist who founded socialist societies. Lanark, and New Lanark here in Indiana, and Fourier, and there were all sorts of idealistic socialists like Proudhon and Kropotkin and
Kropotkin.
Yeah, all right. You pronounce it your way, and I'll pronounce it about my way. Anyway, Carl, bless him, didn't like those kinds of socialisms very much. And he had to struggle in the labor movement, and he was a leader in the labor movement, what was it, the world, the
International
Workers of No, not the IWW.
International Working Men's Association.
Association, right. A very sexist title, by the way. Women's Christian Temperance Society was a whole lot less sexist, or actually it was, you know, it was a women's society, but it had men as members, and they were for the 8-hour day in 1871, and they were for abolition of slavery. They came out of the abolitionist movement, but because they were Christians, they didn't think slavery was very nice, and they wanted people to be free. All right, how do you liberate people? It takes a social movement. And if that movement is not democratic, the result is usually not very democratic. And that's why there were differences amongst the socialists in Russia. For instance, you have Mensheviks and Bolsheviks. The Bolsheviks had a majority at one socialist conference held in London, by the way, and they, but the point of the, any movement wants to say, you know, we've got history on our side. It's inevitable that we'll triumph. And I'm afraid that some Marxists were known for their saying that it was inevitable that Marxian socialism, particularly their Bolshevik Marxian socialism, would triumph, because they had successfully had a Bolshevik revolution in Russia. And therefore every other Socialist Party that really wanted to be revolutionary had to learn from them and be guided by okay. them and have their leadership approved by them.
Tim, are you trying to say something?
Yeah, time's up, Brahm.
A bit of a problem. And it made relations with such Marxists very difficult for the other Marxists and for other people.
To all of you guys who think that socialism and communism is bad, just remember what happened in 1961. However, I'm thinking to myself, we have buried you.
Come on, Sid, wrap it up, man. Wrap it up.
Bye, Rose.
Sid, wrap it up, bud.
Unless all right, there's Sid. Somebody else who's going to give a rebuttal.
Unless.
All
right. Let's hear it for Sid, our speaker. Wrap it up, Sid.
Everybody's talking about it. Russia and what happened in the so-called satellite nation. But the United States invaded 100 countries during the 20th century, either by itself or through surrogates. And if you look through Latin America, you look to Greece, if you look to different parts of the world, where the United States has bases around the world.
Yeah.
It has over 800 bases around the world right now. And what is he saying about that? Nothing.
Nothing.
This is supposed to be democracy. This is supposed to be progress. When you're invading over 100 different countries, and you're dominating those countries, and you're exploiting those countries, you're exploiting its labor, you're exploiting its resources, and nothing is said about that. That's all he says is democracy, which is phony.
Two and five now.
People looking out. Two and five.
I ain't going back.
Nothing like an impassioned information.
Let's
go invade a few small countries before it's not
enough.